Thank you, Dr. Mayaram. And first of all, I'd like to thank IGC for inviting me here, for giving me an opportunity to visit Lahore. My mother belonged to Lahore, so I've always heard about this beautiful, interesting, historical city, and I'm really, really excited to be here. So thank you very much. Let me start with let me just give you a background of what we're doing here. I'm going to talk about something that nobody here has actually mentioned, and that's globalization and financial globalization of countries like ours. India has opened up since 1991. We've allowed both FDI and foreign portfolio investment to come in. We've also allowed Indian firms to borrow from abroad, and there are policy questions linked to these issues. I mean, there are questions linked to the impact of foreign capital flows, to whether they are stabilizing, destabilizing, do we need them, does it benefit us, does it hurt us? And on many of these questions, the answers are not clear. And every day we change our answers, especially after events like the global financial crisis. You must have heard a lot of people say, oh, we've changed our mind. We used to think such and such a thing was good, but it's not good anymore. Let me start with the broader research agenda that this paper is part of. So in the morning you heard discussions about how there should be research and policy maker engagement, and that it should have local capacity. And this research agenda actually has all that. So I belong to the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy in New Delhi. We have had a research program with the Department of Economic Affairs at the Ministry of Finance for the last 7 years. We've been working with them on many of these challenges that the ministry faces when it comes to choosing policies about capital flows, capital controls, macroeconomic stabilization, exchange rates, and so on. We provide them research-based evidence support. Of course, sometimes policymakers accept our suggestions and sometimes they don't. But you know, that is a political call, and it is up to the government to accept or not accept, depending on many other factors. But on this one element of this engagement that has been taking place, it's a very meaningful and fruitful engagement. It works in two ways. One is that when it comes to policy questions, the government sets up various committees, and we have been the research team for those committees. And second, on a day-to-day basis, we have been supporting the Ministry of Finance on some of these questions and by providing our inputs. Some of this work has been supported by IGC, and at least two of the papers here, which are part of this program, and you see the list here, which is primarily on foreign equity investment. They have been supported by the IGC, including, of course, the paper that I'm going to present now. Also, it has now, we've started another project which is being supported by IGC, which is on debt. So it's about Indian firms borrowing abroad. So these are various elements of various dimensions of the same problem, various dimensions of the financial globalization. The program looked at what happens under normal times when foreigners are investing in Indian equity markets. How does that impact Indian equity markets, exchange rates, interest rates, and other macroeconomic variables? Then we felt that a lot of the concern of policymakers was really not just about normal times, but also about crisis times. So the paper that on foreign investors under stress, which was again supported by the IGC, was, so what are the main concerns of policymakers? They're worried about behavior under stress, really. So the May to July episode when Bernanke talked about tapering is what worries them much more than when everything is fine and when, you know, the world is nicely chugging along. So they worry about what happens under investment. They say, if we have a domestic crisis, will it be that foreigners will make it worse by running away at that time? So are they just fair weather friends and they dump us when times are bad? is it that we have very small markets and foreigners are big fish in a small pond? They come in with $10 million and, you know, that really destabilizes our markets. And what if, like in the episode that we saw in July, if there's a problem abroad, if there's a problem in the US market, is it that we get hit without, for no fault of ours? So these are some of the concerns that policymakers have. Before I go into the evidence, especially because this is a conference where we've been hearing a certain kind of evidence being presented, I do want to say that in this field, we don't have the luxury of doing RCTs. We cannot choose 10 countries or 20 countries where we put in $10 billion of foreign equity investment matched by another 20 who don't get the same amount of foreign equity investment. We often cannot establish causation. Some people try to do quasi-experiments by matching countries. And I mean, like the Brad DeLong table that Atif was showing was about matched countries similarly. Some people do try to do that. But when you try to talk to policymakers and sell them that, oh, you know, this is a matched country, and no country obviously matches. I mean, all we hear policymakers tell us is India is different. So they don't buy those arguments at all. So it's very hard in this case to convince the academics. In the morning you heard arguments about how it was easier perhaps to convince academics but harder to convince policymakers. We often face the opposite problem. It's very hard to convince academics in a world where today everyone wants to do an RTC or a quasi-experimental study, yes, have clear identification, is not satisfied with correlations but wants to see causation. So with those caveats, I will start my paper. It is a struggle, but what we would try to therefore do is to show you the evidence, show you the correlations, and then try and see if we can convince you that perhaps there is some causation there. And even if there isn't, how do we think about how can we establish causation? So in the previous study, we saw that there were no very significant impact to be seen of sharp changes in foreign equity investment on various macroeconomic variables. However, that may not be true for smaller markets. India is a large liquid market. The Indian equity market is the third most highly traded market in the world by number of trades. NSE, the National Stock Exchange, is at number 3, Bombay Stock Exchange at number 5. So there's a lot of liquidity in that market. So it might be that these results don't hold for smaller countries. And because of that, we've started now looking at 7-8 countries. It's hard to collect data. We need daily FII data, foreign institutional investor or foreign portfolio investment data to be able to analyze something like this. So we're looking at about 7-8 countries trying to collect the data for that. And the second thing that we're trying to look at is that, okay, we've looked at results that aggregate over all firms. And as I said, that may not be true for all firms. Some might be impacted more than the others. So you can imagine, for example, that if foreigners move in and out, it might be that the smaller firms get hit more because, you know, those markets are not very liquid. Or it may be that the larger firms get hit more, and we'd see what the evidence tells us. And that's the last one, that is the analysis at the level of the firms is what we are trying to look at. Now, why do we look at extreme events? First, because when we did look at just normal, did a VAR, we did not see much. So what we've tried to do is say, let us pick on those events where there were very sharp inflows and outflows of capital, so like tail events, and we take 5% on each side and classify those as the extreme events. So it's not a typical event study. A typical event study is when you say such a thing happened, for example, such an announcement, let's say an M&A announcement happens for firms, and you line up the dates of those announcements as event zero, and then maybe look at the following week and see what happened to stock prices at that time. So that this is different from that typical event study. What is the data set that we have? Now, we're very fortunate. SEBI is the Securities Exchange Board of India, that is the stock market regulator. It has released a lot of data for firms and for trading. And it also requires every company to give quarterly disclosures at the end of each quarter on who holds shares of that company. So foreign institutional investor is one of those categories. So we can see where, in which companies do foreigners hold shares and how much. And we can make a quarterly time series of that data. So we get data from SEBI on that. What we see is that it's 99% of the trading is happening in just about 384 companies. So though the data set has 5,000 plus companies, there are about 2,000 companies in which there is some foreign investment, but they don't trade those actively. It's only about 384 firms where they trade actively. So we've picked on those 384 firms because for the others there wasn't much activity to do any tests. What is the data set that we construct? Now, SEBI also releases daily transaction by transaction data for foreign investors. They remove the identity, of course, of the investor. So though we don't have the identity, but we do get all these fields where we say who transacted, the script name, the company, and so on and so forth. So we are getting the delta each day. Okay, so it will say that for this company, where we can identify the company, these were the buys and these were the sells. And so for each company, we can, if we had an initial starting point, we can build up this data set and look at the level of FII throughout between the two quarters. So once we've got the quarterly data, we know the levels. And then from this data set, we construct the changes. So we basically get a daily time series of foreign investors in each and every one of these 384 companies. So this is just extracting this data. We use the event study methodology where what we have done is we want to look at shocks specifically to the firm. So we use the typical augmented market model, using it to purge the stock market returns of the firm for macro variables. So for Nifty and exchange rate, basically after you run the market model, you take the residuals and what you get is those things that hit just that firm. So that's used then to specify the tail events or the extreme days for the firms. What is one trying? One is basically trying to say that if something hit India, okay, that's not firm specific. That's happening across the economy. So we want to identify just bad days for the firm over and above what had happened to the economy. So putting the putting aside Nifty or the INR USD changes. Okay, so what do we then get? We get roughly 7,000 events in each of these tails, and we break this up into quintiles, and that gives us a lot of observations in each quintile. So the test is powerful. Basically, to summarize the data set, and actually the bulk of the work we have done is to construct the data set. We are just exploring the questions that we had asked, and this is work in progress and it is not complete. But just construction of this data set was hard work because many times they don't match. So if you start with a quarterly date and you build up the changes that happen, then at the end of the quarter, it should match with what the company has reported its foreign investment will be. And there are times when it doesn't match. So then we've had to throw away the data, we've had to look at it very carefully. And that's really been the bulk of the work that was done and which took the most amount of time. Then we look at questions about before we ask whether these firms, whether firms' stock returns responded well or badly to sharp movements in FIF flows, we want to establish that it wasn't something quirky about the market that was leading to the results that we get. So we just ask some simple questions about the market. What does this say? That when the market moves, then after that, pretty much the exchange rate is stable where it was. So if the market has moved, then it's, an index is pretty much stable at the new level. So it's not that we see evidence of overshooting in the market. Otherwise, it would have gone up and then come down, or in the first graph, it would have gone down and then come back up. So the market is pretty much what one might expect it to be. For the event days, we look for 5 days before and after, and I'm in the interest of time, since I'm I just have 5 minutes, so I'm not going to go into the details of this, but basically what it is trying to say is that there are some opportunities available for foreigners to make money when the market is going up or down. But when you look carefully at what they do, then these opportunities are not really exploited by them. Now, this is part of what one might see as home bias. I mean, it's not as if they know anything more about Indian companies than Indians do. It's not as if they're smarter than foreign investors. They're primarily engaging in positive feedback trading. So that's when things go bad, they start selling and they keep selling. And when things go well, they start buying and they keep buying. So their behavior is not something that is bringing something new or adding to information in the market that in the Indian stock market. Now I turn to the, having established what the market looks like, I turn to the question of what we are seeing in terms of different kinds of firms and the heterogeneity of the impact. Here, the only thing to look at is the first quintile, really, where we see an impact. It is that the most liquid firms are the ones that they start selling, in which is odd when there is a good event. In fact, they sell it, they should have sold perhaps at a time when the prices were high, but this is not what they seem to be doing. When we have a very bad event, then again, this is the first quintile, or the most liquid firms are the only ones which see any impact. What are we seeing here? That they start selling, and then you see the price go down and they continue to sell. One cannot say from this, because there's no causation here, one cannot say whether the FIIs predicted the stock market going down, of those stock returns of those firms going down, or whether it was their selling that pushed those stock returns down. So there is absolutely no causation being established. It could be either of the two things. So what have we learned basically here? That they're not very smart, at least not in a market like ours where they are small players and perhaps they've put in a few fund traders. Still, they do better on the days when things go badly. So they are able to perhaps better predict or cause some of those bad days. Before I finish, I want to go back to the question of that I raised in the beginning. So what happens when there is something that happens, say, in the US? So the VIX measures, the VIX measures uncertainty in the market, and when the VIX goes up, uncertainty is higher. And what we see here is, I'm going to skip the evidence, but basically what we see here is that when the VIX goes up, equity investors in India sell. Who are the companies who they sell? They sell the most liquid companies. In fact, they don't sell the least liquid companies at all. So the most liquid are the two things that we are seeing. One, that when things go bad in the US, FIIs sell the most liquid stocks in India. The second thing we see is that when FIIs sell the most liquid stocks, the stock returns of those most liquid stocks goes down. Now, as I said, we have not established any causation here, but this is something to think about, that it is not the small ones who are suffering, as one might have intuitively thought. It is the large liquid firms who are suffering. In conclusion, This is a novel data set. We think we have a contribution on the methodology. The first paper is already published in International Finance, but that's on the macro effect, so that it's pretty much similar methodology. We think that this data set offers us an opportunity to study how global shocks may be transmitted to Indian stock markets, and there is a lot more work to be done. And as I said, we need to think deeper about causes and consequences. Thank you.